realize where a lot of times when people get older, they say, oh my gosh, this is terrible. There's not much to look forward to. We have everything to look forward to, because while we're here on earth, God's going to bless us. We have the blessings of God. And when it's time not to be here on earth, we get eternal blessings. So let's give the glory to our God, our Mashiach, our Yeshua. Let's lift him up all the time in our life. But when you do get older, you do have some things that you forget and everything. And like there was an elderly couple that had dinner at another couple's house. And after eating, they left the table and they went into the kitchen. And the two men were talking. And one said, you know, last night we went out to a new restaurant and it was great. I would recommend it very highly. So the other man said, well, what's the name of the restaurant? And the first man thought, and he thought again, and he said, oh my gosh, this name slipped my mind. What's the name of that, you know, that flower you give to someone you love? You know, the one that's red and has thorns. And he said, you mean a rose? And he says, yes, yes, that's the one, replied the man. He then turned toward the kitchen and yelled, Rose! What's the name of that restaurant we went to last night? And one more thing. They weren't in my pockets. Suddenly I realized I must have left them in the car. Frantically, I headed for the parking lot. My husband had scolded me many times for leaving my keys in the car's ignition. He's afraid that the car could be stolen. I looked around the parking lot and I realized, oh my gosh, he was right. The parking lot was empty. I immediately called the police. I gave them my location, confessed that I left my keys in the car and that it had been stolen. Then I made the most difficult call to my husband. I left my keys in the car and it's been stolen, I had to say to my husband. Moment of silence. I thought the call had been disconnected, but then I heard his voice. Are you kidding me? He barked. I dropped you off. Goes on. Now it was my turn to be silent. Embarrassed, I said, well, come and get me. He retorted, I will as soon as I convince this cop that I didn't steal your darn car. Okay. So journeys are great, and let's pray that we all have our short-term memories alive and well. Short-term memories seems to be the ones that are tough. Long-term, I still remember friends and stories and phone numbers and birth dates from, I can say, 50, 60 years ago. But my wife can ask me to get her something. Say, oh, okay, I'll get it. And I walk in, I walk into the bathroom, and I say, what am I here for? Let me think about this. And then I have to say, my office. My office, right. She wanted her purse that she left in my office. You know, you have this short-term memory, you forget. But journeys are awesome, because journeys are set by the Lord. And when we go on a journey, like we read in Numbers 33:1-2, Eileh Maseh B'nai Yisrael, these are journeys of B'nai Yisrael when they came out of Egypt by their divisions under the hand of Moses and Aharon. Moses recorded the stages of their journeys as Adonai's command. So it's interesting. Why are there stages in journeys? Why did they write it down? Because God commanded it. And why does God command us to write these things down? Because as we go on journeys, he wants us to learn from each stage. And from each stage we go through, he wants to bring us closer and closer and closer to him. As my wife would always say when she speaks in different groups, we are on the move with the Lord. And how do you stay on the move with the Lord? You're on the move with the Lord when you go through these stages and you learn from the Lord, he tells you things and you cherish those things in your heart. And you have, like, in Numbers 33, verses 1 to 49, there's a list of details. Seems pretty unimportant to your modern way of thinking. Who cares about the itinerary that took place 5,000 years ago? So you have to ask the Lord, well, what am I supposed to learn from this? So how can this be relevant to our own life? And the important word was in verse 2, where God commanded to put the stages down. God commanded that. And so what we have to do in our life is, when we're on a journey, we have to meditate about these personal journeys. And we should put these travels down from one place to the next. As they traveled from Kivrot HaTa'ava, which is in Numbers 33:17, the name of that place gives a deeper meaning, a lesson. It you learn from the name Kivrot HaTa'ava, which means burial place of desires. And isn't that interesting that God sent Israel into a place that means burial place of desires? Because that's what God wanted for Israel and wants for all of us. Put your desires down, bury your desires, and keep alive what God wants you to know and what God wants you to say. And you know what? I see the Galeckis here, they're some of my favorite people. I know them for years. Rachel and I know them for years, and we love them. A great part of our congregation that we used to have up in Orlando, and their children have grown so much, and you just look beautiful, and it's just so wonderful, wonderful to see you. You know, when you get into your 70s, you know, you realize you are a father, and these people are our children, and we love them. So it's a wonderful, beautiful thing. And one of the things that I know, you, Janet and Sylvester, how you always were careful about things your children would watch or listen to or something, because you wanted them to get filled with the Spirit of God, not with the ways of the world. And in this life now, it's very tough because the ways of the world are trying to come into us, and they want not for us to bury our desires. They want the ways of the world wants us to bury the things that Hashem has told us, to bury the word of God that is in us. And we need to be blessed by holding on to the word of God. So when you go on a journey, you know, I remember there are a couple of journeys that I've been on and throughout my life. And one of them was our journey to Orlando. We were in Palm Beach County. We had a large congregation. It was about maybe 250, 275 people we lived in Palm Beach Gardens, and the congregation was in West Palm Beach, and we knew that God was calling us to go on this journey. We were going to leave where our family was, and I have to tell you, we were up in Orlando for about 14 years, maybe 15, and you know something, it was troubling for us, but we kept our eyes on the Lord. But what was troubling, I mean, we loved being up there, we loved the people we worked with and everything, but our families were home in Palm Beach County. And you know, we have 5 children, 7 grandchildren, and 3 great-grandchildren, and 1 new great-grandchild on the way. And 2 of our great-grandchildren live here in Fort Myers. And so we were, you know, being so far away, It was tough, but it was a journey that God sent us on. And how did we know that it was, it definitely know that it was God? Well, there's so many ways of knowing through the Word. And of course, it was back then I was president of the MJAA, and we were at a meeting, and I told all the leaders, we had about 25 leaders in there, and I told them, and there was such a strong affirmation that they agreed, yes, it is time for you to move and come up here, that God has a work for you here. So it's a journey. In other words, it's a journey. But journeys mean, it doesn't mean that you're going to think about it, you're going to work it out, how can it be best for me? Journeys are, I will do, God, whatever you want me to do. We have to get it confirmed, of course, but that's what journeys are. And so when we read about these journeys that they went through in Marseille, we read about it, but we have to relate it to us. And I'm sure each and every one of you have a story about the journey that you are on or were on. How many of you have journeyed in different places through your life? Raise your hand. Okay, see, almost all of us have. And how many of you remember meditating on it and wondering, is this the right thing to do? Yes, all of you too. So it's the same thing. And what we see in these journeys is, like in Psalm 48, 11 to 15, like your name, O God, so is your praise to the ends of the earth. Your right hand is full of righteousness. Mount Zion is glad. The daughters of Yehuda rejoice because of your judgments. Walk about Zion, go around her, count her towers, consider her ramparts, go through her palaces so you may describe it to the next generation. For this God is our God forever and forever. He will guide us to the end. Can we stand on that and believe that he will guide us to the end? Yes. And we all need direction to get us where to go. And it's the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit, who lives within us, if we will only let him lead. That's the trick. We have to let him lead. Because so many times, like when those desires, those ways of thinking, oh my God, I can't do that. Oh, gosh, I have such a great job now, and I'm doing so well, and all this. How can you be asking me to do this? Because you don't know all the blessings that I have for you, says the Lord. He is sending us on assignments, and when we can follow him in that, and know that it's the Lord, like we had to do all these different times, and we know, we have to let him lead. And verse 5, Jeremiah chapter 2, verses 4 to 8 says, hear the word of Adonai, O house of Jacob, and all the families of the house of Israel. Thus says Adonai, what fault did your fathers find in me that they strayed so far from me? Can you imagine this? The God of all creation has his children. He loves all of his children. He loves the Jewish people, and he also loves the nations, and he loves the Jewish people and nations the same way. And yet he chose the Jewish people to be a light to the nations. He took care of them. And then he says they walked after worthless things, becoming worthless themselves. We have to not walk after worthless things. In these days, it's so difficult these days, because good is spoken of as evil. Evil is spoken of as good. In these days, we have to stand on the strength, the power of the Almighty God. And And in Romans 1:21, again, they walked after worthless things. But in verse 6 of Jeremiah 2, from 4 to 8, they didn't ask, where is Adonai who brought us up from the land of Egypt and led us through the wilderness, through a land of deserts and rifts, through a land of drought and distress, through a land where no one travels, where no one lives? They didn't ask about that, but they went through it, and he says, yet I brought you into a fertile land to eat of its fruit and goodness. When you came, you defiled my land. You made my heritage an abomination. And so we think about it in our journeys. We think about it. We went up to Orlando, and it took us a while to get up to Orlando, but we went to Orlando, and just wonderful things occurred. And we started having a beautiful Jewish. that's a new word, Jewish. A beautiful Jewish ministry in Orlando. We started having it, and all good things started working out, and it was just wonderful. But then all of a sudden, later on, because for so many years we had a congregation there for about 15 years, and later on it was different. What was taking place, because it wasn't really a Jewish ministry anymore, and you know, we were called for it to be a Jewish ministry. And so what, there are certain things that happened, certain stages that we went through, that we realized, you know what, we're really not supposed to be here anymore. God is moving us. He's moving us back down to Palm Beach County. What's that?
The signs.
Yes. There were all there were these signs. And some of the signs you may look at and say, oh, that's so ridiculous. But it's not ridiculous, because just like God made you, it said, write down every single stage. These were signs. These were stages. My wife and I are very evangelical. Not in a denomination. We're Messianic Jews. But we are evangelical. We love to go and speak to our Jewish people and tell them about the Lord. And we love to speak to people of the nations and tell them about the Lord. We don't care who it is, what color, where you're from, what you did, what you didn't do. We don't want to know about all that. We want to know, do you know the Lord? You don't? Well, let me tell you about it. That's the way we are. So we used to walk into the mall. It was the mall. It was the Florida Mall. And we used to walk in there, and there was Nordstrom's there. And Saks was there, and those were two places where a lot of Jewish people would go. They go to buy things that they wanted there. But we went to malls, and we went to the other mall. I forget the other mall's name, but we went to the other mall too. And we would walk and not go to look for shopping. We used to go there to walk around and just speak to people. We were fishing people. That's what we were doing, fishing souls because we wanted to bring people to the Lord. And when I was in my practice, I'm a retired eye doctor, and when I was in my practice, I led more people to the Lord in my practice than I did in the 15 years I was in Orlando. So I started seeing some signs. I'm saying, hey, nothing's happening now. I'm not leading people to the Lord anymore. Yeah, there were different people that we did, but it used to be so much, and then we were hardly meeting the people. And when those two stores closed down, when Nordstrom's and Saks closed down to us, I said, you know what? This could be another one of our signs that it's time to go. Not because of Nordstrom's and Saks. I don't care about Nordstrom's and Saks. But because of the people and the salespeople there who we used to minister to and see. And there were so many Jewish people that we were ministering to. And then all of a sudden, we have no one to witness to, no one to minister to. And it was such an amazing. So that was one of our signs. And then we went through another stage, and there were a couple of things. And then we had to move. And then we had to move. We were in one place, and then we had to go to another place. And it just seemed that it was just changing. It was changing. And I loved, as the rabbi there and as a father of my congregation, I loved, and even still today, I love the people who were in my care. It doesn't matter, and this is something else, when you're on a journey, it doesn't matter if someone really did something wrong to you or spread a rumor about you or said anything. It doesn't matter. The thing, what matters is, do you forgive? And if you can't forgive, God won't forgive you. And I told this man, I went into a candy store. It's a place where I take my little 5-year-old granddaughter, and I take her there. And I went to get a Jewish journal, and I always take it and go out. And he said, "What are you doing? What are you taking there?" He was in the back, and I said, "I'm taking one of the Jewish journals." And he said, "Well, you're gonna have to pay $1, and you're gonna have to put it into the can for the Chabad." So I said, "Well, why?" He said, "Well, you're not a customer of mine." I said, "Yes, I am." I said, "I come here all the time with my granddaughter." And he said, "Well, I don't recognize you." I said, "Well, you know why you don't recognize me?" He said, "Why?" I said, "Because, aside from the fact that I had my Yankee hat on, but the reason why he didn't recognize me is because I could just discern in the spirit. He was so angry, not about me, but about people coming in and taking the Jewish journal because he wants them to buy things in there, and a lot of people just come in because they want to take, it's a weekly paper, it's free. So he was so angry that he was blinded by this anger. And I said to him, "Okay, something is wrong here. I've seen you before. You are too angry. What's the matter? You have to tell me. I know that there's something wrong." I said, "Because right now I see that you are so angry. You are so angry that you're stopping God moving in your life." And he says, "Well, I don't believe that, and I don't believe in God because he allowed my wife when she was 61 to die, and she suffered for 3 years." I said, "Oh, that's terrible, but you have to understand." And I started ministering to him, and when I ministered to him, all of a sudden you could tell that the spirit was getting softer and softer and softer. And then he said, "But you didn't even put $1 in the can." I said, "Well," he said, "you're not a mensch. You didn't put $1 in the can." So I said to him, "Yeah, oh, okay. I didn't even see the can, and I didn't even know you wanted me to. But, but I'm trying to deal with you now." So I dealt with him, and he was getting softer. And then at the end, he said, "Well, anyway, I reject all this stuff you said about God." So I said, "Okay." So I said, "Okay, that's fine, but I will be praying for you." And I went out, and as I went out, and I said, "Ooh, I got to get $1 out. I got to show him I'm a mensch." So I went in and I took the dollar and I said, "Hey, here's the dollar." And I gave it to him. He said, "Don't give it to me. Put it in the can." And I said, "Okay, here's the can. I'm putting it in." He says, "Okay, thank you." And he softened. And whatever it takes, you soften. But these are different stages that you go through. But anyway, when we were up in Orlando, we just... went through different stages where we knew it was time for us to leave, because we had a whole community of people, Jewish people, not only our family, but Jewish people in a place where we moved in, where it's 98% Jewish, and they need them, they need their Lord, they need the Messiah. And I just knew it. And so I went to, we were talking to someone, we had a meeting with this man who's, he was an elder in the Lord, not in my synagogue, but an elder in the Lord. And we were just talking to him and telling him what we feel. And he said, that's interesting. He said, I have a word for you. And he went to, he had one of those boards on these chalkboards, and he took a piece of chalk, and he wrote, this is what God said to me. L-E-A-V-E, leave. He said, it's your turn to lead. You're getting all the signs. You know, because I only told you one story. But there's so many different things that happen. And he said that. And we just knew that that was it. And I said, okay, God, this is going to be tough. It's going to be tough. But we have to leave because you're telling us. And we don't want to go against you. I say, if it's not of you, then stop us. Then stop us. But we've had supernatural miracles in our life all the time, just like that, just like with that book, how it came out. It was an amazing thing. I'll tell you like another story, is that what happened, and this was another part of our journey up there. Because I was up there, you know, I met different people, Christian people, who were leaders in the community. I would always be at different things that they were in. And every January, we had the last 3 weeks in January, we would always have a fast. And then it was 2 or 3 days before the end of the fast. And I said, God, I know you put on my heart to write a book. If this is of you, Lord, then if this is of you, then you have to give me a supernatural sign. Any of you ever ask God for a supernatural sign? Raise your hand if you have. Okay, you see, a bunch of you have. So what happened was the fast ended 2 or 3 days later after I prayed that. The fast ended, and I get a call, and the person said, hello, Rabbi Kluge? I said, yes. He said, this is going to sound bizarre. This is Steve Strang calling. And I said, oh, Steve, hi, how are you? Good. And we schmoozed a little bit. And, I mean, he wasn't like a friend of mine or anything. He was just, you know, someone who I knew, an acquaintance who I knew, a nice guy. He's the CEO of Charisma and all those magazines. And he said, this is going to sound bizarre, but about 2 or 3 days ago, God put your name on my mind and my heart that I should call you and tell you you need to write a book for us. So can you imagine that? I was praying in the fast and that happened. These are miracles. Miracles take place in stages. And I'm just giving you, I'm not going to tell you about every stage and everything, but I just want to tell you, we have to trust God and trust that we are on the move with God. We have to do that. We have to believe that we're being led on a journey, and the journey has stages. And take each stage, and when it happens, when things happen, when blessings happen, write it down. When things that do not appear as blessings happen, write it down so you can meditate and see what is God saying. This is just so important. And this is what we get from Masay. It's because a lot of times you read it and say, I don't really care about reading this. So they went here, then they went there. But there are reasons, and there are things that happen, and you have to read it, and you see it, and you have to relate it to yourself. He will always guide us. Psalm 119, 105 is, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. You don't need a top secret security clearance to read God's word. It's no secret. It points us in the right direction and keeps us on the right path. In John 16:13 says, but when the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all truth. He will not speak on his own, but whatever he hears, he will tell you, and he will declare to you the things that are to come. When we pay attention, we will stay on the path we're supposed to be on. And we have to understand the Word of God must take priority in our life. It's only through the Word of God that we are able to correctly judge and discern our circumstances and control our feelings. The Spirit of God will never lead us contrary to the Word. Never. An example of someone looking for a path is a small girl had been promised the privilege of climbing to a nearby hilltop where her brother enjoyed playing. But when she came within sight of the steep, rough path, she drew back in dismay. Well, why isn't there a smooth spot anywhere? It's all bumpy and stony, she explained. Yes, said her more experienced older brother. But how else would we ever climb to the top if it wasn't? You see, the stones and the bumps that we have to step on to get there. Job 23:10 says, yet he knows the way that I take. If he tested me, I would come out as gold. In other words, we have to have the bumpy parts, the stones. We have to have the times of being uncomfortable. We're all on a verge because of things that are happening in this world. We're all on a verge of a significant spiritual shift, and spiritual tides are beginning to turn and as the Lord is drawing us into his word. And I'm going to just finish with these next few things. God is calling us to be a fisher of men and a fisher of women, but not from a distance. He's calling us to get into the boat, get into the boat and fish and get your catch. We need to reach out to our Jewish people, and we need to reach out to the nations also. The Jewish people first, but also the nations. We have to reach out. Let's not be afraid. Let us go fishing, and let us understand that even with Peter, as great as the catch was when he couldn't get anything, and then Yeshua showed him that catch, it pales into comparison to how radically the lives of those who found themselves on the shore that day were about to be transformed. We are getting transformed. And I have plenty of other stories of journeys, but we're not speaking about it. We're going to end with just a couple of questions. How far does God have in your journey of life? How far is God in your journey of life? Can you think of times when he was closer to you? Can you think of times when he didn't feel as close? He was always close to you. He never leaves you nor forgets you. But the thing is, how close do you feel with God? And if you don't feel close, then get into prayer. Just repent and just seek him. Read his word. And are you letting God guide you, or are you trying to guide God? We in our flesh have a tendency to want to guide God. It's not intellectually we think that, because we know we can't guide God. But we, in our flesh, sometimes we think we're guiding God and he's not guiding us. And finally, are you ready to leave the shore and become something more? God wants you to become something more. He wants all of us to be more, because we're in this time of evil is good and good is evil. And God says each and every one of us can make a difference. We must get up out of the boat and make a difference. And then it's the end of the chapter. It's the end of the book of Numbers. We say, Chazach, Chazach, V'ni Chazek. Be strong when you do it. Be strong. be strong and strengthen one another, and then you have all the tremendous blessings of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Rabbi. Just incredibly compelling that we have the Parsha, of course, talking about journeys and stages, but just the examples of Rabbi Michael and his mother, my grandmother, others that we've lost, Joan, others that we're waiting to see, John battling cancer, Cheryl, others. And it's just these are the bookends. At the same time, we're dedicating Nolan today, and we're celebrating new life. And these are the bookends of life, but in the middle is this, yes, absolutely, a journey, and a journey not for the faint of heart, requiring all of our courage. Thank you. Baruch Hashem. We're going to take up an offering now. If I could have Barry and Jerry do the baskets, please. We're going to take up an offering. Please, if you're making out a check, please make that check out to Gesher, G-E-S-H-E-R, International. That's the name of the ministry. If you would like to make a check out, or cash is also accepted. We're going to say a prayer over this offering and also over Rabbi and Rebbetzin's ministry, that Adonai would just abundantly bless, be fruitful in everything they do. Abba Bashamayim, we ask God that you would increase these gifts. We ask God that you would increase your anointing, your power, your spirit on Rabbi Charlie, Rebbetzin Rachel's life and ministry, that they would go forth with anointing and power, that their words would bring forth life, that their words would bring forth truth, that they would see deliverance, salvation, healing, blessing, increase in all the work of the hands, of the prayers of their hearts, that you would do this thing for your love and for your glory, on their behalf, for their service to you. We love you and we praise you this day. B'shem Yeshua HaMashiach. Amen, amen. We'll go ahead and take up an offering now. Again, if you can make this out to Gesher International. We're going to continue worship. You're welcome to stand if you like. You're welcome to dance if you like. We have prayer up front if you would like prayer during this time. Louise is available to pray with you.
Upon the ground, and our hands to heaven raise, we cry, you form formed us from the dust. And to the earth this frame returns. But while these lungs are filled with breath, we shout glory unto you. We cry, holy, holy are you, Lord. We cry, mountains shake as we fall upon the ground. Your breath consumes us, Lord. Your great fire overwhelms. You are
Shimcha.
Hosheana Adonai, Hatzlichana Adonai, Ha'er Panecha. Ana Adonai, Hosheana Adonai, Hatzlichana. By a noble theme, bringing blessed words unto my King, giving up my love as a sweet offering. Oh, the beauty of this man, for the sake of love left his father's throne, searching for a bright bone of his bone. Such a humble gift to make her dust his own. Oh, the beauty of this man. Oh, the beauty of this man, Yeshua, I love you. I give you all my worship, Yeshua. Instead, his feet and his side, they bear the marks of wrath of your sacrifice. To secure her love by giving up his life. Oh, the beauty of this man. With love beckons him to come, establish righteousness as God's risen Son. Oh, that glorious day shall marry her fair one. Oh, the beauty of this man. Oh, the beauty. Yeshua, I love you. I give you all my worship, Yeshua, I love you. Your name is Yeshua, I love you. I give you all my worship, Yeshua.
I'll say a blessing over you to dismiss you this morning.
Evarech Adonai Yad Ishmarecha Yaher Adonai Panav Elecha Vikunecha Yisa Adonai Panav Elecha Ve'asem lecha shalom.
The Lord bless you, the Lord keep you, the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance on you and give you rest, peace, shalom. Shabbat shalom. in remembrance of Yeshua, in remembrance of his atonement, his true atonement for us, eternal, wrought and accomplished for us, our forgiveness, our standing, our reconciliation and restoration with him. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech ha'olam, borei pri hagafen. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who brings forth the fruit of the vine. Amen. In remembrance of Yeshua, the true bread of heaven, the true bread, our daily bread. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech ha'olam, hamotzei lechem min ha'aretz. Amen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, King of the universe, who brings forth bread from the earth. Amen. Shabbat shalom. You may be seated. We're going to have our own egg now.